Perception is extraordinarily misleading. In fact, its purpose is to give us the impression that the impossible has happened. For instance, look at the spacing of these fan blades, okay? And we can plainly see, okay, there's spacing between these fan blades, right? Now, we're going to turn the fan on and take a second look. Okay, we just turned it on. Now, to perception, it appears as though the distance between the fan blades has changed. And it looks as if there really isn't any distance between the fan blades, right? Because of the rapid rotation. Now, if we slow it down a little bit, it might appear there's a little more distance between the blades. Slow it down again, and you see that there's now you can see, I see, you know, some distance here. And finally, all the way off, and it will, you'll be able to see the, you know, you see, oh, okay, now I can see the distance properly. Oh yeah, there is distance between the blades. How about that? But turn it on again, and that distance between the blades seems to change. The impossible seems to have happened. Boy. The conclusion that we want to draw is that light is not equally responsive to all. That's the conclusion we want to draw, because that, to us, it means that we have been able to change the light. Okay, we've been able to change reality. We've been able to change God, because God is in God's creation. So if we change the light, we've changed God. So it's a way that we play out our fantasy of being able to change God, is to believe that we're seeing unequal action by light, by the light. And perception very much plays into this whole scenario. And so does the whole notion of energy that we have here, is that it takes more energy to do this and less energy to do this. And so it seems like it takes more light to do this and less light to do this, etc., etc. None of this is actually true. It's simply we have designed, we asked light to design for us a scenario in which it seemed as though light is not light. And so we have this very deceptive scenario called existence. Very deceptive scenario called existence. And those who want to keep their spiritual ambitions, keep on this ego trip of spiritual ambition, certainly want to dwell in such a place. Those who have been able to evaporate their continuity fear, which is really the only problem we have, to a large extent, they don't really need all these props to make it seem like the impossible is possible. And so there are spiritual realms that are way more spiritual. They don't give the impression, false impression, nearly as much. And those realms will always exist as long as we have a continuity problem. See, it's God's will that the continuity problem be resolved for us, okay? It's not the will of light. Light does not have a will that way. Light is impartial. So whatever you ask for it, it will provide for it. Light is not lobbying for us to drop this crazy idea we had of trying to change the light. It's not like that. It's the prime creator that is urging us to look at that we have a continuity problem, and that there's a way to address this. It's the Holy Spirit who is addressing this, not the light directly. The Holy Spirit is requesting of the light for these other realms and these halfway houses, so to speak, to rehabilitation places. And those places will be kept viable until everyone has melted away the continuity problem. So this ridiculous belief by many in the world that they're going to get rid of spirit, you know, get rid of God, get rid of God's plan, you know, is not going to happen. They may find themselves in a situation where there doesn't seem to be any of that, but it still exists. It's just they're blinded to it. They don't want to see it, so they don't see it. It's that simple. So it's really about attention. Attention is so important. That's why I say there's a battle on for our attention, because there are many in this world who want our attention to not rest upon God's remedy for the continuity problem, to insist that there is no such remedy, it doesn't exist. It's like saying my eyes are closed, I'm scared to open them, so I'm going to claim there are no eyes. There's nothing to see and there are no eyes. And they want our attention to be pulled down so far that we don't even notice what the help is available. And it's, you know, this trend has been going on very severely here in the world, and it's going to get way, way worse coming up. Got about 2 years before it's basically, what do you call it? It's gone so far that it may be time to split into two different realms, so to speak. The difference between people are so severe that it really requires two separate realms to accommodate the situation. So it would be good for 2 years to just not pull any punches and to see where that gets us after a 2 year push. Don't pull any punches, just tell it like it is. And it may very well come to a separating of separating out between the sheep and the goats, as it were. The goats wanting to continue to pursue their spiritual ambition, the path of spiritual ambition. The sheep are the ones who want to repent. They want to repent. Repentance is work. I mean, you really have to work at it, because you have a severe continuity problem. Admitting you have a severe continuity problem is the first step. Admitting you have a problem is the first step. And then you do have to work at it. And it's a lot of work, but it's good work. It's honest work. It's effective work. And ultimately, it will succeed. So if there's a situation where there's a world that is controlled by the ideology of non-repentance, that there is no path, there is no God, there is no salvation, there is no repentance, there is no path to God, no repentance, all that is a mental illness, or something, that's how they look at it, then the Holy Spirit will say, hey, you know, okay, fine, but we're going to have a realm for those who do want to repent. Thank you very much. And there's nothing they can do about it, because the light is responsive to the Holy Spirit also. And the light is responsive to everyone equally. And so you can't block somebody else from experiencing what they experience. It's not really possible at all. So these people who want to deny that this is possible, they cannot block those who want to be repentant. They cannot. What they can do is put blinders on and insist they don't see these people. These people don't exist. They're insane. They can say all this kind of stuff. But they cannot actually block the repentant from their path of repentance. It's not possible. They believe it's possible, but it's not. They just go into a state of denial, put their head in the sand, so they don't even see it. So again, light is equally responsive to all. So your request is fulfilled by the light. Now, if someone else requests that your request not be fulfilled by the light, that doesn't work. It doesn't work. What happens is light will present a situation in which the person, the one requesting that, has blindness. I mean, can't see that the light is fulfilling the other's request. So when you start trying to, you know, block others from what they want to experience, you yourself will end up feeling that the light is not responsive to you. And you will not be able to see examples that the light is responsive to all equally. You won't be able to see that. That's what happens. So you have this delusion that the light is following your orders and block and not being responsive to someone else. That is not possible. But the illusion that this is so seems to take place. And even when you go to a better situation, they will deny it. They'll say, no. No such possibility. So, you know, hardcore denial based on their spiritual ambition of believing that they can change how the light functions, the equality of the light, the omnipresence of it, the equal responsiveness of it to all. They want to be able to change that. And so they will simply deny any evidence that it's not changeable. Absolutely so. What else can they do? They can't change it, so they can just deny the evidence that this is so. And so they sink into darkness and darkness and darkness and darkness. It's ignorance. It means to ignore the evidence. Ignorance means to ignore the evidence. So they will just ignore the evidence as they do. I mean, they ignore the great examples in history, right? What we've been shown. We've had some great examples just recently in the world in the last 100 years, some tremendous examples. I mean, I think, who was born in 1897? I think Sri Nisargadatta. Anandamayi Ma was 1896. I think Krishnamurti was 1897 too. I mean, the 20th century had a lot of great examples. And the world right now is choosing to ignore it completely. Instead, they're obsessed with, hey, I can, you know, I can send a tweet, or I can send a selfie. Oh my gosh, this is incredible. Who needs to pay attention to any of the great examples that light can't be changed? We don't need to. This is way more interesting. Well, that's what they're doing. That's what they're doing. And this is actually an expression of their spiritual ambition, tremendous spiritual ambition, to continue to insist that the light can be changed. But we're not sitting in judgment of that, because we've all been there too. We've all been there too. We're just tired of it. Some of us are getting tired of it. After a while, you get really tired of that. And you say, I don't want to do that anymore. So they're just not yet at that place where they're really tired and say they don't want to do it anymore. They're still saying, hey, this looks really cool. I want to do this some more. Well, fine. There's no problem. Go ahead and do it. But you can't control us, what we do. I mean, our requests of the light, you know, will be met too. And what they want to do is insist that we not request from the light what they don't want to see, the evidence they don't want to see. They say, no, you have no right to request this from the light. Not true. We do have the right. We can request it. So what they're really trying to do is try to get us to agree to not request anything from the light that they don't want. You know, not request it. So they can then continue their game of claiming that the light is, you know, not equally responsive, and that they can block the light from functioning. And they're afraid that if we request what we want from the light, it will respond. And they don't want that. So they want to kind of, you know, cheat the situation by indoctrinating everybody to simply don't ask of the light, and then they can claim, see, the light's not doing anything because nobody requested it, is why, you see. That's why. not because the light is incompetent or unequal or incapable of responding properly. Absolutely not. It's because we didn't make the request. See, that's the issue. So we absolutely have the right to request that we see, literally see, be aware of, our attention is aware that the light does respond equally to all, and that there are no problems except the continuity problem. We have absolutely every right to see that, and we must request this. We must request this vision. Say, I request this vision to see the evidence. I must see the evidence. We just simply are insisting not that we not see the evidence. The evidence is there. We're just insisting on not seeing it. So we're not seers, okay? Not seers. And the world is becoming a place of not seers. Now, the world will say, hey, look at all the beautiful stuff in this world. Look at this. I mean, put your attention on all this kind of stuff, okay? And you need to say, well, no, I want to put my attention on seeing, my attention to see the equal presence of light, the equal presence of light, the equal presence of light. That is what is truly the evidence that we need to resolve this issue that we have. Has the light been changed? Can we change the light? And in order to resolve that, we have to actually see the evidence. So we cannot spend all our time just saying, well, these flowers are very pretty. That's all I need to see. No. That is not all we need to see. It's not that we don't have to ignore the flowers, but this is not what we need to see primarily. We need to see that the light has equal presence everywhere. Equal presence everywhere. That's called the vision of oneness. That's what we need. So it's very helpful while we look at these flowers, the evidence of beauty, to very adamantly insist this is not the answer. Okay, and we don't want to be stuck in a world, in mindset, that is told that this is the answer, that beautifying the world is the answer. It is not the answer to our continuity problem. The only answer to our continuity problem is to see the equal presence of light. The equal presence of light. It is equally present everywhere. And that is very powerful evidence. It's not the ultimate evidence, but the evidence is so powerful that we're then able to take the final step. We're not afraid of the final step anymore, which is to see the equal responsiveness of the light everywhere. Okay, that's the final step. The intermediate step is simply to see the equal presence of light anywhere. So we tend to think, well, this is, you know, beautiful flowers here, and the light is more present here with these beautiful flowers, okay? Beautiful form. Oh, okay, the light's very responsive, beautiful form. And not as responsive to other places. That is not true. That is not true. So we need to be aware of the light itself, the presence of the light that is omnipresent, equally present everywhere, right now, right now, right now. Okay, that's the intermediate step. And of course, we like to see pretty things, etc. But that should be entirely a secondary situation. Entirely a secondary situation. And at all times, we should be reminding ourselves that is not the answer. Because the way the world is going now is towards this obsession with beautiful form. Okay, thinking that's the answer to prove, well, you see, we're able to make light responsive to our high-tech ability and our ability to do all this genetic engineering and monitoring all our plantings, et cetera, et cetera. We'll be able to build this like paradise, make this sort of a paradise world with so many beautiful flowers and stuff. That does not solve our continuity problem in the slightest bit. That is a massive, massive, massive delay. Okay, no matter how beautiful the flowers are, that is not the answer whatsoever. The answer is that the light is equally present everywhere. The light is equally present everywhere. So you see things that are maybe not so beautiful, you see, compared to the flowers. But the fact is the light is equally present everywhere. Equally present everywhere. And that is what needs to be, your attention needs to see this. It's actually a fact. And we just are not turning our attention to that fact. But once we turn our attention to the fact, we see all is one. The light is as equal presence everywhere. And then from that standpoint, we're able to take the final step, which is light is equally responsive everywhere. World more and more and more, and it's just a global obsession. Is a bluebird just showed up right there. It's interesting. Okay, that's what's called the Antichrist way, actually. It seems beautiful. It seems beautiful. But what it does, it avoids looking at the available evidence of the vision of oneness. It avoids it. It's like the alternative to it. It's saying, hey, don't have the vision of oneness. Let's just look at this beautiful form. That's good enough. That's why it's Antichrist. It's not the answer. In the West, we say spiritual practices, spiritual disciplines. In the East, they call them tantras. Tantras really means spiritual practices. The West has distorted this to a terrible extent. They're promoting sexual practices, tantra, as that's the meaning of it, which is not so at all. That is just a very minuscule subset of spiritual practices. Spiritual practices have a vast array of spiritual practices, or tantras, which have been developed throughout history. And one of those is dwelling in burial grounds or cremation grounds. So some spiritual practitioners will actually do their meditations and live in the most terrible places. And what this does, it helps them realize that all of this so-called material realm is really terrible. It's not what we want at all. There's really no real difference between anything in this world. A beautiful flower soon becomes a withered, fragmented piece of dust. And it's interesting that in my life, I've spent the last 10 years in spending a lot of time in landfill, garbage dumps, horrible, horrible. And now it doesn't bother me in the slightest bit. You know, and it's just, I see really no real difference between a garbage dump and a palace. I really don't. Palace ends up in the garbage dump. Most definitely. That's what the garbage dump is made of, is broke remodeling palaces, really. And all these beautiful flowers end up there also, in a stinking, rotting garbage, you know? And so it helps you realize that seeing form is not the answer. Seeing beautiful form is not the answer. I'm not suggesting that we fixate on ugliness or anything like that. But in your life, you may find that certain practices arise where you're in a situation where you do have to deal with seemingly ugliness. And don't let the ugliness trap you into thinking that beautiful form is the answer. Oh, I got to compensate by beautiful form. Beautiful form is going to solve the problem for me. Beautiful form never solves the problem for us. The only way our problem is solved, which is continuity problem, based on spiritual ambition, believing that light is not equal, is not equally responsive, it's not fair, it's not omnipresent, it's not equally omnipresent, it's not... The only way we solve that problem is to see the equal presence of the light. That's the only way. We most certainly don't solve the problem by believing that this light rests specially on certain beautiful forms, that the light is involved with specialness, special treatment, etc. And we reinforce this by seeing, you know, beautiful people, beautiful form. Oh, the light is treating them so much better than it's treating me. Then we get the idea that the light is not impartial, right? Which just reinforces our delusion, which makes the continuity problem even worse. And the cult of form, you know, takes on different guises, but it's always meet the new boss, same as the old boss, really. Right now, it seems like the cult of athleticism is an ascendancy. The cult of the toned and tanned and athletic and perfect teeth and facial features, and you know, just, you know, instead of the older Victorian way of the flowers and the soft femininity, the cult of that sort of thing. Now it's the athleticism, cult of the, you know, the vigorous, athletic Amazon sort of thing or something. It keeps changing how we keep worshiping form. Okay, and ignoring the evidence, having our attention ignore the evidence. The evidence is there. Our attention ignores it. It's called ignorance. Ignorance means ignoring. We ignore the evidence. We refuse to let our attention shift to the where the evidence can be seen, which is the equal presence of light, vision of oneness. It's there to be seen. Now, we do not need to be fanatical in an attempt to prove a point. We're simply trying to be effective and be intelligently effective. Okay, so unfortunately, my cat passed away, our family cat, and passed away, and the cat is lying in state here. And so we have many beautiful flowers here before the cat is buried to honor this cat, who was really an incarnation of the light, as we all truly are. But this cat seemed to give, you know, more evidence of this than most form does, for sure. Was not blocking it so much, really. So the cat was really a guru, a producer, a guru, a friend, and a presence, and all that. And unfortunately, the cat passed away. So we use flowers to symbolize the light, that the cat is going to a beautiful realm where the light doesn't seem to be so non-responsive as it does here, right? Okay. So that's all fine. That's all fine. No, nobody needs to be a fanatic. What we need to do is just a successful practice, which is to let reason talk to us. Let reason talk to us. And we just need to listen. Listen to reason. Listen to reason. And let it talk to us. And then we will draw the correct conclusions and realize the only problem that we have is the continuity problem. And the only way to solve that is the vision of oneness. So we just get to work on that. And you have the juxtaposition here. You have a beautiful flower, and then you have the incense stick, which has been turned to ashes, you see. So you have the combination of the ashes with the flower. And it reminds us that the ashes and the flower are really one and the same. And the light is equally present everywhere. Light is equally present everywhere, in spite of our attempts to make it seem that there's some huge difference between this flower and the ashes. And we assume that there is, right? Because of the beauty of this flower and the seemingly non-utility now of these ashes. But the light is equally present everywhere. Equally present for this flower, equally present for the ashes, equally present everywhere. We just need to be able to see that, which is to turn our attention to this fact. And the absolute stillness of the light is also present, equally present everywhere. Even though there's all these different noises taking place here in our world, the fact is that the instantaneously responsiveness, the instantaneous spontaneous responsiveness of light is such that it's absolutely still, absolutely still, absolutely still in terms of anything other than that happening, you see. It's smooth, it's quiet, it's serene, it's still, it's completely instantaneous. So sometimes we have these noises, and we have to realize that the light is absolutely still in its perfect instantaneousness. The perfect responsiveness of light itself doesn't make any sound or vibration at all. It's only our requests of what we experience that give rise to these appearances of vibration. It is not the responsiveness of light that gives rise to any vibration at all. It's only absolute stillness, absolute quiet, absolute serenity, the actual responsiveness of light. So whether the vibrations are noisy or the vibrations are quiet, the light itself is absolutely still. Always equally pure. There's no variation anywhere to cause anything that we would say is a vibration. There's no difference, no differences that would give rise to what we call a noise or a disturbance. Undisturbed, the responsiveness of the light is undisturbed. But that quietness does sound nice, doesn't it? Yeah. But there's a quietness within that is truly undisturbed by anything, by any activity, any action, by anything whatsoever. Undisturbed. And our attention can rest upon that. Now, this cat was very camera shy. I made it clear, did not want to be in any of the videos, so I honored that request. But I managed to work him into this very, very helpful video. And I hope that's okay with him. Because it's actually very, very helpful to point out this and super important subject matter. As we prepare to say our final goodbyes, this cat will certainly live on. This cat was really very instrumental and helpful with all these videos I've done. A constant companion and encourager in many ways. And will certainly be missed, and perhaps the next phase is on its way. I wouldn't be surprised if there's another phase now that's going to take place in all of this. Okay. Rest in the light. Rest in the light. Rest in the light, cat. Rest in the light, our friend. My friend, and the friend of light and truth, really.